knows a lot about all kinds of stuff. Professor Dave Explains.
We just learned how to find power series solutions to linear differential equations of the form y double prime plus p of x times y prime plus q of x times y equals r of x, and we saw that it's quite a powerful technique. However, one limitation of the method is that it assumes that the functions p, q, and r are all infinitely differentiable at the point we are expanding about, which we denoted x0. This is not always the case, and a common workaround is to modify the previous method into something called the Frobenius method. We first need a little terminology. For a general function f of x, we say that the point x equals x0 is a singularity of the function f if it is not infinitely differentiable at x0, which means that f is either discontinuous at x0 or not differentiable at x0, or both. For example, the functions 1 over x and the absolute value of x both have singularities at x equals 0. Referring to our general form, we say that the point x equals x0 is a singular point of our differential equation if any of the functions p, q, or r have a singularity at the point x0. For example, if p of x is 1 over x minus 2, then this dE has a singular point at x equals 2. A singular point is further classified as a regular singular point if, when we multiply p of x by x minus x0, and when we multiply q of x by x minus x0 squared, the singularities of these functions disappear. And we can see that this is the case for our example singularity at x equals 2. If we use the Frobenius method to find a power series solution about x0, then the radius of convergence for our series will be greater than or equal to the distance between x0 and the nearest singularity of p, q, or r, and this result is known as Fuchs' theorem. The payoff is that if we use the Frobenius method to find a power series solution about a point x0, which is a regular singular point of our differential equation, and x0 is the only singular point, then the radius of convergence of the resulting power series will be infinity. This is far better than the Leibniz method, which cannot handle singularities like this at all. Let's see an example to illustrate the point. We want to find a power series expansion for the solution to 3xy double prime plus y prime minus y equals 0. We first need to get our differential equation into the standard form, where the coefficient of the highest order derivative is 1, so divide both sides by 3x. We now see that our coefficient functions have singularities at x equals 0, which is the point we want to expand about, so we need to use the Frobenius method. Also, since we can multiply our p of x, which is 1 over 3x, by x, and our q of x, which is minus 1 over 3x by x squared, in order to remove the singularity, x0 is also a regular singular point, and our Frobenius power series will converge everywhere. We begin by subbing in a power series for y, except in the Frobenius method, we modify the exponent from n to n plus k, where k is an unknown constant. As before, we then differentiate this and substitute it into our differential equation in standard form, absorb the x terms into the summation, re-index the summations to make all the powers of x the same, pull out the first term of the first two summations to make their indices all start at n equals 1, and then combine the summations and set everything inside and outside the summation to 0. It looks messy, but this is the exact same process as we did in the last tutorial. When we set the expression inside the summation to 0, we will generate our recurrence relation between the terms of our series an, just as before, but now there is this unknown constant k. To find k, we set the expression outside our summation to 0, and this will yield something called the indicial equation. In our case, the indicial equation is a quadratic equation in k, and we can solve it to find that it has roots k equals 0 and k equals 2/3. In the Frobenius method, if the roots of the indicial equation are distinct and do not differ by an integer amount, which is the case here, then we are finished here. We just put each of the two values of k into our recurrence relation to get two different recurrence relations, which gives us the coefficients for two linearly independent basis solutions for y, where we have chosen an initial constant a0, which can be different in each case. As always, adding these two basis solutions together gives the general solution. Now let's discuss what to do if the roots of the indicial equation do differ by an integer or are repeated. In these cases, our two solutions, y1 and y2, will not be linearly independent, so we need to do more work. What we do in these cases is take one of our roots, and we conventionally choose the larger one and use that as usual to generate a series for one basis solution, which we'll call y1. For the smaller root, we take a similar form for y2, but we add on the additional term y1 times the natural log of x minus x0. In order to find the coefficients of our second basis solution, y2, which we've called bn, we need to return to the step where we found our first recurrence relation for an. This time, instead of substituting in our indicial equation roots, we will keep this recurrence relation general so that we can find an in terms of n and k. We need to evaluate each of these terms separately, meaning we need a1 as a function of k, a2 as a function of k, and so on. To find b1, we take the expression for a1, differentiate it with respect to k, and then plug in our second root k2 for k. Likewise, to find b2, we take the expression for a2, differentiate it with respect to k, and then plug in k2, and so on, for as many terms as we wish to compute for the series bn. In order to save a bit of time, when faced with a differential equation of the form y double prime plus p of x times y prime plus q of x times y equals 0, and we want to use the Frobenius method, we can actually write down the indicial equation straight away. The indicial equation in this homogeneous case will always be k times k minus 1 plus u0 times k plus v0 equals 0, where u0 is the constant term in the Taylor series of x minus x0 times p of x, and v0 is the constant term in the Taylor series of x minus x0 squared times q of x. We can then immediately solve this to find the roots of the indicial equation. We then substitute in our power series, shifted by a general k, and go through the normal process to get a general recurrence relation for an, and then based on the roots of the indicial equation, we can decide whether we just need to sub each root in, which was the easier case, or whether we need to sub one root in and use the differentiation with respect to k method to find the values of bn, which were for the trickier cases. Even so, the Frobenius method can take quite a while, especially when the roots of the indicial equation are troublesome. But for differential equations that have singular points, as is the case for many of the ones that crop up in scientific applications, the Frobenius method is often the only approach that works. And the guarantee of getting an infinite radius of convergence out of it at the end, in the case of a regular singular point, makes it well worth the effort. Let's check comprehension.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.